Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul. I worship your holy name.
So here we are on Sunday number 2. Of not being able to meet together in the church building for a time of worship. That said, however, hopefully, what we're discovering together is that our worship of God is not just limited to the physical space of this building. Yes, we gain a lot from being able to come together and gather around God's word and worship together and pray together and meet each other's needs, but no, worship is not something that is limited to this space only. Worship is something that you can do every day when you open up a devotional, such as the Our Daily Bread booklets that the church gives away. You know, you can even go online to receive those devotions on your smartphone or on your computer. And when you read the scripture and you reflect on the stories and the thoughts that they bring up, guess what? You are worshiping God. When you pray for your family and for our church and for those who are out of work right now and for those who are sick with this virus or other things, guess what? You are worshiping God right where you are. Do you go outside for a walk to just kind of de-stress and get exercise and get the stress out of your life? Well, what a great time to be praying that God would remove this coronavirus from our world and that He would give wisdom and insight to the medical researchers and the scientists and our governmental leaders, especially during this time. What a great time to be worshiping God as you thank Him for your family and for this unprecedented time to be together like you've never done before. Ask God how you can be a blessing to your family right now. Because you see, that is also worship. See, worship isn't just limited to the church building. As important as it is for us to come together and to worship God as His people, as His church, we're needing to become creative in how we maintain connection with one another in this stay-at-home time. And I want to thank Carolyn Smith for helping to pick out the worship videos that you just enjoyed right now. I also want to thank Craig Smith for taking time to record a thought for our online time together with the Lord's Supper. I want to thank Mary and Glenn Gearland for their help in recording this message. Finally, I want to thank Ashley Kindle for her able assistance in putting all of this time of worship together for us on the church website. So I'm going to get really honest with you right now. These messages that I'm preaching, I've called Carriers of Christ. And they're really important to me because I'd be lying to you if I said that I never felt any anxiety regarding these times that we're in currently. And I'm not panicking, but there have been times when I felt anxious, such as when I'm going down that toilet paper aisle at Walmart and the entire row of shelves is empty and I'm thinking, good night, what in the world is going to happen if we run out of toilet paper at our house? I don't even want to think about that mess. But you know, a couple of days ago, I was at Kroger, and I was shopping for some other stuff, and I thought, I'm just going to go down the toilet paper aisle and just to see if anything's there. I didn't really expect anything to be there, but you know, I must have gotten there just in time because there was a 12-pack amongst all of the other rows there, and there was just a few other toilet papers there, but I was able to get this 12-pack at Kroger's, and I thought that I had just found the pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. You know, on the outside, I'm like, no big deal, you know. I got some toilet paper. I mean, truth be told, I was a little embarrassed to put it in my shopping cart because I didn't want to look like all the other maniacs, you know, that are desperate for toilet paper right now. But on the inside, I'm like, I got it. I got some. Hallelujah. God is good. Glenn and Mary, stop. They're storming the stage. I got to put this stuff away, man. Well, isn't that crazy? It's crazy times we're in right now, you know? I mean, I think about this on a more serious note. A week and a half ago, when all of this was first breaking out and things were shutting down, I literally, it was like I was just sitting in my office for 2 days with a headache, just feeling overwhelmed and burdened about what to do. And it's like, how am I supposed to minister to people and pastor them when I can't even be with them? How are we going to stay together as a church when we can't gather together on Sunday mornings? You know, what can we do to stay connected and to be part of each other's lives when we're under this order to shelter in place by our governor? How are we going to help people in need when we're not even supposed to be together? And I had a serious headache for 2 days because of all the stress I felt. But you know what? I'm getting through it. I'm figuring it out, just as you are. And we will get through this as a church as well, because the church isn't just a building. We call it the church. It's a valuable space for us. It means a lot, because that's where we gather to bring encouragement and resources to one another. But the church is really the people, isn't it? And so wherever you are, wherever you go, you are the church. I'm calling this current series of messages we're in Carriers of Christ, because that's what the church does, and that's what the church needs to be. We carry Jesus to all of the places we go. Your home, the woods, the grocery store, your essential business, your neighborhood, wherever you go, the Bible tells us to be carriers of Christ. As I continue to think about what that looks like, what that means for us right now, I think of the Bible's words in 1 John chapter 4, verse 18, where we read, "There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear." Isn't that great? What a great truth of God's word. And so today, I want to talk about how we can live out of love rather than live in fear. How can followers of Jesus live like that during times that are uncertain? When the world seems to just be spinning out of control and people are feeling afraid, what can the follower of Christ do to live with that kind of love that drives out fear, because we belong to God who sacrificed everything for you and me? Well, here are some ideas that might make a difference for you. Ideas that will help you to live out of a love that comes from God in these trying times, rather than live in fear. You see, what we focus on is important, because what we focus on is what's going to become strongest in our life. So the first idea I present to you is this: concentrate on prayer. Concentrate on prayer. Now is a wonderful time to pray, because prayer will help you to focus on God as you learn to navigate through these uncertainties with Him. Prayer should be the first response of the follower of Christ in times of trouble. But you know what? Prayer is often the last thing we do. And I wonder if that's because we so often want to be controllers of our own destiny. However, our current situation makes it obvious that we cannot always be in control, can we? That's why it makes sense to keep our eyes focused on God as we live life driven by the God of love. Call out to the Lord like the psalmist did in Psalm 31, verses 14 and 15. He cries out, "But I trust in you, Lord. I say you are my God. My times are in your hands." Jehoshaphat, one of Judah's ancient kings that we read of in the Bible's Old Testament, he is a good example of one who prayed in troubling times. A coalition of powerful enemies were moving in to attack the nation of Israel. If they weren't stopped, they would destroy the nation. They would totally engulf it. And the first thing this godly king did was to call the nation to prayer. And he led in the praying. As he prayed, he reminded the Lord that God had pledged to deliver his people. Jehoshaphat began by affirming his faith, as we read in 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 9. It says, "If calamity comes upon us, whether the sword of judgment or plague or famine, we will stand in your presence, before this temple that bears your name, and we will cry out to you in our distress, and you will hear us and save us. And what is especially encouraging to read is the manner in which he concluded his plea to the Lord God, as we read in verse 12 of 2 Chronicles 20. He says, "We do not know what to do, but our eyes are on you." Our eyes are on you. Listen, each of us is more like Jehoshaphat than we might imagine. Our nation is attempting to respond to a crisis that we've not faced before. In some respects, we are entering into a new world and we need divine guidance. Well, how can we pray? What should we pray for? Maybe you have better ideas than me, but I can give you at least one place to start if you're looking where to start in your prayers. Pray for peace. I'm not just talking about the cessation of war and violence, although it includes that. What I'm really talking about is pray for peace of mind, both for yourself and for others. Pray for peace for your loved ones. I mean, just this last week, I was talking with an attorney friend of mine who said that after this crisis is done, there will probably be an influx of cases going through the courts involving domestic disputes and overconsumption of alcohol. It's true. Families who aren't used to spending so much time together might find it difficult to get along. And so we need to pray for peace in our families. And we need to pray peace for our nation's leaders, that they would lead with courage and act with discretion and honor because their mind is filled with the peace that comes from God. Pray this for the leaders in our own communities. Pray this for those who are stocking the grocery stores and the products that we need on the store shelves. Pray for those first responders and those who are working in the hospitals, working long shifts for the public's best interest. Ask God to give wisdom and peace of mind to the scientists and the researchers who are seeking to find a cure for this virus. Pray that God's peace would be with those who are sick right now. When so many are acting out of fear, we who follow Jesus need to be filled with his peace. We who follow Jesus, we need to focus on he himself who went out in a time of crisis and yet always had peace because he was motivated by love and he was connected with the Heavenly Father through prayer. And I'm talking about Jesus. The New Testament indicates that there were numerous times when Jesus would go off by himself for prayer. Now, if Jesus concentrated on prayer, certainly we should concentrate on prayer so that we are focusing on God too. Well, what else might you focus on so that you are driven by living out of love rather than living out of fear? How about this idea? Control your mind. You know, as Jesus was preparing his disciples for his crucifixion, he said this, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid." That comes out of the Gospel of John. Isn't that interesting? Concentrating on prayer to God, who created and owns the universe, can help bring peace into your life. But if that's going to happen, if God is going to be able to bring peace to us, it requires some intentionality on our part. You know, we have to do our part to control our mind. In these uncertain times, what that means is you allow God's peace to rule in your life. And his peace will rule in our lives as we focus on him and what he has provided for us as his people. When the Apostle Paul wanted to encourage the small congregation in the Roman city of Philippi, when it was under pressure to conform to secularism and immorality, Paul gave some very significant counsel to that church, which we read of in Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 through 9. There the Apostle Paul says, "Rejoice in the Lord always, and I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. We are taught in this passage to refuse to allow anxiety to control us. We are to pray about everything. We are to look to God for his help as we continue doing what needs to be done. And as we focus on God, God's peace and his perspective will be extended to us. Focus your mind on those things that are true and honorable and just and pure and lovely and commendable. Invest time allowing the Lord to speak to you through his word. Now would be an excellent time to begin reading and memorizing scripture. Read the Bible with your family. Memorize significant passages like the 23rd Psalm or the opening words of the Gospel of John. Lead your family in memorizing key passages of the Bible. In other words, fill your mind with God's word. It will help you to control your mind. You see, Paul refused to allow his thoughts to just kind of run wild. He refused to allow himself to become anxious. He didn't necessarily know what the future held, but he was quite confident of who held the future. He knew who was in control of the future, and that gave him perspective. Perspective makes all the difference in the world. Having the right perspective comes when you make it a habit to control your mind. In fact, that's why Paul could also say these words that we read in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 16 through 18. He says, "Therefore we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen, since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal." Allow the Spirit of God to rule your mind by inviting him to lead you in the way of love and by refusing to give in to fear. Now, so far, I've shared a couple of ideas that might help you to focus on living out love instead of living in fear. Those ideas are concentrate on prayer and control your mind. My last suggestion for focusing on living out love rather than living in fear is this: continue your responsibilities. Continue your responsibilities. We're not seeing as much of one another as we are used to. And we're having to either stay at home or work from home, many of us, but that doesn't mean that life just stops. That doesn't mean that we just stop contributing towards what is good. It doesn't mean that we just become fleshly lumps that sit on the couch all day long. During these times of social distancing, remember that as followers of Christ, we are not to neglect one another. Though we may not be meeting together as before, we can still encourage each other. We're taught in Hebrews 13, verse 16, "Do not forget to do good and to share with others, for with such sacrifices, God is pleased." We who love the Lord are taught to encourage one another. And so Paul, he urges us, even as he instructed in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 11, encourage one another, build each other up, just as in fact you are doing. Though you may not be able to spend time with one another as you were able to do before, we are blessed to have phones with which we can call or text each other to see how one another is doing. Perhaps you are on Facebook, and if so, you can message others to encourage them not to grow discouraged or to see if there's something that you can do to help them out if they've got a need. If you are forced to be away from your usual work and you're not able to work at home, now would be a good time to complete some of those little chores that have been waiting for you over time. This is a great time to start getting things done that you haven't been able to do. And so these are some practical applications of the biblical instructions that I've just mentioned. Last week, as I was listening to a video by John Maxwell that he had put out there for church leaders, he shared about a survey that had been done almost 30 years ago. That survey, done in 1992, was done the year I came to this church as your minister. And in 1992, this survey showed that the top three things that people were concerned about at that time were finances, their job, and their health. Can you believe that? One would have thought that survey was taken yesterday. And I think that survey shows once again that things don't really change all of that much, whether you're in crisis or out of crisis. Things that concern us really don't change all that much. And it just reminds us, and it reminds me, that there are always things that would distract us in order to keep us living in fear. And so the question is, as we wrap up this morning, the question is, what are you going to focus on? What are you going to live for? Are you going to live for fear or for faith? Are you going to live for fear or love? Feed your faith, starve your fears. Because see, I'm encouraging you this morning to live a life that's driven by love, not by fear, because what you focus on will grow more strong in your life. Remember 1 John 4:18. Perfect love drives out fear. What will you do to love someone more perfectly today? Don't live in fear, live out love. Do something. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, in this time, it would be easy to just panic. It would be easy just to sit around and do nothing. But God, as your people, you've called us to live courageous lives. You've called us to live out love. And so for each person hearing these words and listening to this message today, I would just pray that you would give them insight for how they can live out love in their life. May we not become inward and self-focused. May we continue to show care and love for the others in our lives, because we know what Jesus did for us. May we be faithful stewards of the life you've given. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And so we remember that Jesus didn't hide away in fear when people came after him. He lived his life in love. He allowed his life to be put on that cross so that you and I could have salvation and eternal life with the Father. I want to encourage you to let this time remind you of how important it is to draw close to God, who loves you and who went to the cross for you. Not only did he die on the cross, but 3 days later, he rose from the dead, and he is our sure salvation. God bless you.
And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then